Outside of a few exceptions, the rivers and lakes of Florida have kept the names given them by the Indians. They sound musical when properly pronounced. Escambia, Choctahatchee, Chattahoochee, Wakulla, Ocklawaha, Withlacoochee, Wekiva, Okeechobee, and the Suwannee, immortalized by Stephen Foster. The most beautiful river of them all is the Ocklawaha, now doomed by the Cross-State Barge Canal. These are a few of the more well-known streams, but historically, the most significant river in the state is the Apalachicola, one time called the breadbasket of the South. Long before the Spanish discovered Florida, Indian villages were scattered along this waterway. The rich soil produced vegetables for the communities. The forest and river gave meat and fish. The people lived in harmony and peace. In later years, before Georgia was formed and named, slaves from the Carolinas would manage to escape, eventually making their ways to one of the villages along the Apalachicola, where they would be accepted into the tribe. Through intermarriage and prolific breeding, their numbers increased rapidly over the following several generations, and these mixed bloods would be referred to as exiles. In the year 1814, two British ships anchored in Apalachicola Bay and began discharging men and equipment. Lieutenant Colonel Nichols was officer in charge of this expedition. Their purpose: find a site upriver and build a fort to control this strategic waterway. 30 miles from the mouth of the river, they built a strong fort, fully stocking it with cannon and smaller arms. They had no qualms that this was Spanish territory. The British suddenly evacuated this fort, going downriver to waiting ships and embarkation, leaving behind, to the bewilderment of the exiles, a complete arsenal of powder and weaponry. Andy Jackson, after his victory at New Orleans, was appointed commanding general with jurisdiction as far south as the territorial border. From his headquarters at Nashville, Tennessee, orders were issued to Sailing Master Loomis at Mobile, Alabama, and an army officer, Colonel Clinch, stationed at a post on the Flint River. The orders stated that this Negro fort posed a threat and must be destroyed in all haste, and immediately thereafter return the captured slaves to their rightful owners. Colonel Clinch, with troops and Indian allies, embarked downriver. By midday July 25th, 1816, his troops were deployed, the cannon in place near the stronghold. Sailing Master Loomis left Mobile Bay with two gunboats and sailed upriver to anchor just below the fort. He was at battle stations by the 25th. Word of their coming had preceded the army, so by the time of its arrival, 334 exiles had fled to the fort for safety. After a short conference, Loomis and Clinch began shelling the fort, and for 2 days they kept it up, the balls having little or no effect against the thick walls. Another conference was held and a decision reached. The gunboats would this time use hot shot or heated cannonballs. The shelling was resumed. Over the walls they lobbed the sizzling hot shot. One ball reached the powder magazine, and a resultant explosion killed 270 of the exiles outright and badly wounded most of the others. This episode brought about the First Seminole War.